On April the 14th, 1994, seven top executives, referred to as the Seven Dwarfs, testified before the House Subcommittee on Health and the Environment. The purpose of this testimony was to emphasize the committee's effort about the dangers of smoking cigarettes. During the testimony, all seven CEOs were asked the same question: if they believed that nicotine was addictive. And each executive responded under oath that he did not. Interestingly, what the executives did not reveal was research completed by Big Tobacco that proved that nicotine, in fact, is addictive. Nor did they share that their companies, every one of them, invested lots of money to strengthen the addictive power of the nicotine in the cigarettes that they sold. This morning we continue our Lenten series entitled The Big Turnaround, and our focus is on repentance. In Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, repentance means change your direction, change your mind. In the Sermon on the Mount, especially in Matthew, Jesus proclaims the kingdom of God, which is, as Bob Fuller described it, a culture that includes the following values. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and your mind. Love your neighbor as yourself, and love one another as Jesus first loved you. Last week, we looked at the sin of lust. This week, we look at the sin of lying. So I invite you to turn with me in your pew Bibles to page 963, and let us hear the word of God as it is written in the gospel according to Matthew, chapter 5, verses 33 through 37. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, "You shall not swear falsely, but shall perform to the Lord what you have sworn." But I say to you, do not take an oath at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not take an oath by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let what you say be simply yes or no. Anything more than this comes from evil. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Startle us, O God, with your truth, and open our minds to your spirit of truth, that we may be one with your Son, our Lord Jesus, and serve as his disciples. Through the strong and saving name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the Spirit of truth, we pray. Amen. In our scripture lesson, Jesus is addressing swearing falsely when making an oath or a promise. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, "You shall not swear falsely, but shall perform to the Lord what you have sworn." What does swearing falsely mean? Well, it essentially means reneging or recanting on a promise. Swearing falsely essentially means, as Jesus says, it is lying. Now, there's something unusual going on here in the context of this scripture passage. Jesus is teaching about something to the Pharisees that they already know. That is the importance of telling the truth. In fact, telling the truth, being honest, was so important to the Pharisees that they devoted an entire section of the Mishnah to telling the truth and to guarantee the telling of the truth by an oath. The Old Testament allowed oaths. Thus, the Pharisees considered oaths as essential. So what did this system of oaths look like? this Pharisaical system of oaths looked like. Well, the Pharisees divided oaths into two classes, those which were binding and those which were not binding. Any oath which contained the name of God was absolutely binding. Any oath which succeeded in evading the name of God, that person would rigidly keep that oath, but if he swore by heaven or earth or by Jerusalem or by his head or by anything else, he felt quite free to lie and break that oath or that promise. Jesus was saying this had gone too far. Swearing falsely went beyond the courtroom. The lying that Jesus was addressing spilled into everyday business transactions and even worse, into our everyday speech. So Jesus castigated the Pharisees for building this elaborate system of deception and lies. But then, surprisingly, Jesus turns around and says in verse 34 that oaths are totally unnecessary. But I say to you, do not take an oath at all. No man, Jesus is saying, can keep the Lord God out of any oath, any conversation, any speech. God is already there and hears our words, spoken in his name or not. Jesus' message is crystal clear. Don't hide behind an oath, for that keeps you from taking responsibility for what you say. How startling Jesus' words must have been to the Pharisees and to all his listeners. Jesus' words were radical in his day, but they did not mean we should never take an oath or make a promise. What Jesus means is that we may make civil oaths, but we may not make oaths independently without disobeying his command. We obey oaths and make promises, such as serving on a grand jury, or making promises of faith for your child during the sacrament of baptism, or at the Lord's table, or when you stand at this, on these steps of this chancel and make promises to love your spouse in the covenant of marriage. Jesus, in this text, was fighting to protect the integrity of speech and our words. He wanted the lying to stop. So how do we use words? We're in lots of ways. Lots of ways we use words, but one way is through the sin of lying. Jesus noticed that lying happens a lot with people as he continues to do so in the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus focuses on the heart where all this begins. To tell the truth, I lie. And so do we all, I suspect. Dr. Robert Feldman, author of The Liar in Your Life, revealed in a study that new acquaintances tell an average of three lies. That's one about every 3 minutes in a 10-minute conversation. In another study, Feldman revealed that we are lied to every 5 minutes, or an average of over 200 times a day. While in our culture we hear voices that hold up the importance of telling the truth or respecting the truth about lying is that lying is much more commonplace in everyday life than we realize, and lying thus gets excused. So what are some of the ways that we lie? One way is to lie on a college application because we want to get in that school. Or we lie on a resume because we want that job. We really want that job. Another is to lie to make a profit. This one happens much more than we ever realize. At an airline ticket counter, a small boy with his mother told the agent he was 2 years old. This man looked suspiciously at this little boy and said, "Young man, do you know what happens to little boys who lie?" The little boy quickly responded, "Yes, sir, I sure do. They get to fly at half price." As parents, we lie to our children, and we lie for our children. For example, we write sick notes for our children because our children don't want to go to school one morning when they are perfectly healthy. Sometimes we lie to please people, and that's a laundry list of lies. See if this one gets your attention. We lie when we get pulled over by a police officer to get out of a speeding ticket. And when the police officer says, "So you were speeding at 73 over 65. Can you tell me why you were speeding?" We might respond, "Officer, this is something I would probably say. I have a funeral and I'm running late." Or we might say, "Officer, dinner is in the oven and I have to pull it out before it burns." And when we say that, we might lean over our console to protect the taco that we're eating from Taco Garage and the soft drink that's in the console. How many of you have ever received a spam email promising you a share of someone's inheritance if only you would pay several hundred dollars in taxes by clicking on this link? Don't ever click that link. Sometimes people ask us to attend a meeting or do something, and we assure them that we will be there and we will do that, and then we don't show up. We lie about our weight, we lie about our age, we lie about our marital status sometimes, and many, many more. So why do we need to lie? Well, number one, we're afraid to tell the truth and face the consequences. I don't need to go into explaining that. There are consequences. We lie because we need something, or we avoid something we don't need. In either case, we justify the means by acknowledging that lying may not be ethically or morally right, but as long as we get what we need or avoid what we don't need, it's okay. But it's not okay. It's not okay. And most of the time, people get away with lying, but lying exacts a terrible, terrible cost. First, we dishonor God and God's gift of speech. St. Augustine maintained that we should never tell a lie because to do so betrays the very character of speech as a gift, a precious gift from God. Number two, as Jesus' kingdom people, we erode our ability to be trusted. Without trust, our relationships suffer, our community is weakened, and our efforts at loving Christ, loving one another, and loving the city are undermined and even stifled. And perhaps worst of all, when we lie, we erode our own personal integrity. So what is Jesus commanding us to do? Well, look at verse 37. Jesus said, "Let what you say be simply yes or no. Anything more than this comes from evil." Stop lying, Jesus is saying. Turn around and use honest, simple, plain speech in your communication that honors God and builds up your neighbor. Honor God by living authentic lives in the world, obediently telling the truth and keeping our promises so that our promises, our oaths are not even necessary. Scripture reminds us God is truth. There's one thing God cannot do and never will do, and that's tell a lie. Therefore, those people who follow Jesus Christ must talk and walk in the truth. Jesus said in John 14, verse 6, I just read this text yesterday, "I am the way and the truth and the life." And then just a few verses later, he promises the gift of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, that same Spirit of truth that helps us live authentic lives and become truth tellers and promise keepers. His Spirit of truth lives inside each one of us. Christ was honest in his speech and kept all of his promises during his passion to the cross. The road Christ walked, the Via Dolorosa, was covered, smattered with lies. The scribes claimed knowledge they did not possess. The Pharisees claimed to be righteous, but they were not. Jesus' own disciple, Judas, betrayed him with a kiss. And then there was Pilate, pious Pilate, who pretended to be sincere when he asked, "What is truth?" when he should have asked, "Who is truth?" Dietrich Bonhoeffer observed that the truthfulness of disciples has its basis in following and trusting Jesus, through whom their sins are revealed. Listen to this. Only the cross as God's truth makes us truthful. Those who know the cross no longer shy away from the truth. Those who lie under the cross can do without the oath as a commandment establishing truthfulness, for they exist in the perfect truth of God. There is no truth toward Jesus without truth toward other people. Lying destroys community. But truth rends false community and founds genuine fellowship. There is no following Jesus without living in the truth unveiled before God and other people. Trust the Spirit of truth so that you can tell the truth and keep your promises. The Apostle Paul sums it up best with his words. We are to speak the truth in love, not use harsh language to tell the truth, but instead use language of gentleness, acceptance, mercy, understanding, and grace. As we stand before the cross together, we see the truth and recognize that we need Jesus Christ in His grace in order to be His truth tellers and promise keepers in this world. Easier said than done, learning to tell the truth. This is His truth. And keep our promises is not easy. So how do we begin? What steps can we take? Well, the first step is learning to tell the truth to God through prayer, by praying through the Psalms. The Psalms teach us to tell the truth to God because they help us to confess and they reveal our own sins. Warning, when you do that, it will happen. And you may have to share your emotions with God. I encourage you to do that. Before we can learn to be truthful to one another, we have to learn to be truthful to God about who we really are in Jesus Christ. And there's no better way to do that than to pray through the Psalms. And then, each and every day you do that, take the time to pray to God and ask God to forgive you for the sin of lying and any other sins that you have done, and to restore you and give you new life. And then, step by step, trust the Spirit of truth, who leads us all to become His truth tellers and promise keepers for the kingdom of God. One man who lived his life as a truth teller and a promise keeper was C.S. Lewis. From 1919 until 1951, C.S. Lewis kept a promise to his friend, his close friend, Patty Moore. Lewis and Moore promised one another, if one of them died during World War I, the other one who survived would take care of that friend's parent. In this case, it would be Lewis's father or Moore's mother. Moore died in the war, and so Lewis kept his promise. For 32 years, Lewis kept his promise. When Lewis got out of the army, he set up a home, and there he faithfully cared for Mrs. Moore and her 12-year-old daughter. And it wasn't an easy task to accomplish because Mrs. Moore was rude, arrogant, ungrateful, and just downright mean to C.S. Lewis every day. But that didn't stop C.S. Lewis from keeping his promise to his friend Patty Moore. In response, Lewis was emboldened to trust his Lord Jesus and live out his truth every day, day in and day out, with Mrs. Moore. When Mrs. Moore was rude and arrogant, Lewis used truthful words of kindness and generosity with her. When she was mean to him, Lewis forgave her and showed her more and more of Christ's love. One day, Mrs. Moore asked C.S. Lewis why he was a promise keeper and a truth teller. And this is what he said. Before I was a Christian, I was an atheist. This is part of my identity now as a Christian, as a follower of Jesus Christ. I see it as one of my responsibilities as a citizen of the kingdom of God. And it should be important for all of us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.